Aloha, this is Asia Iyer with Maui Pono Network. I come to you with the somber reality of the disasters that we have faced over the last 2 weeks as an island community. I am not here to offer advice in place of legal advice or in place of those who love and know you best. But if you've been affected by these disasters, either you've lost a home, you've lost a business, you've lost your job, you've lost access to your home because of evacuations or because of lack of utilities, or if you've sadly lost a loved one, here's some tips that I hope will help you. After the fires, I offered to go work at some shelters, helping people get registered for FEMA assistance and helping them get started on insurance help. And this was something that I was interested in because I have had a total house loss through a wildfire. It happened 12 years and 3 months ago, so it's still something that I think about almost daily, and it was very traumatic for our family. And this is what was left of the house that was worth keeping. The rest of it was ash. There was a tree that got burned but was still standing, but the rest of the house was completely flattened, including a cast iron stove. All of our treasures from our life, and this is what's left. And so I wept with those who had lost homes and marveled at the miraculous escapes of many people as well. Some of the things that have been really helpful for people so far, and I'm going to go through a list on this, is first registering for FEMA assistance. FEMA has already given money to those afflicted in the disasters for temporary housing to help them get their life going again. But a lot of people who lost other things and not homes don't realize that FEMA is available for them. For example, if you lost a vehicle, it was parked in Lahaina. I have a friend who had some business equipment there. People have lost businesses. And if you've lost a loved one, FEMA actually will help cover funeral expenses as well. So FEMA registration is the primary stop for people who've been affected in a natural disaster that's been declared a natural disaster by the federal government. There's a lot of rumors that were going around about FEMA. This doesn't take your home. You don't sign any deeds. You don't do any of those things. This is just to provide money immediately for your immediate assistance. And I hope wherever you are right now that you're safe and you're comfortable and your needs are being met. And I hope that FEMA has been helpful for you. And that's something to share too, to let people know what FEMA is doing for you so that other people can get their FEMA disaster assistance. There's not a limit on this. It's just going to help. I mean, there's a limit per family, per household, but it can help everyone. Some of the questions that came up while we were registering people, helping people get registered, is who is supposed to register for FEMA? Is it supposed to be the landlord? Is it supposed to be the renter? And it says one per household. So we were having landlords register. We were having the tenants register. FEMA seems to be the most helpful in past disasters elsewhere on the continent for those who did not have insurance, because it will help cover things that insurance would cover. So if you had insurance, FEMA may have denied your claim already, or it may be holding off on sending you money right away. That doesn't mean that you will not be receiving any disaster assistance from FEMA. There is an opportunity to appeal within 60 days of your decision letter. And after you get your insurance payouts, you should contact FEMA and talk with them about what wasn't covered by your insurance if you have an insurance payout. The other thing is to contact your insurance. And I think most people, we're 2 weeks out right now, most people have done this who had insurance. But again, this isn't something that's a done deal. And you need to be careful when you're talking with your insurance that you don't place blame. You don't say what happened. You just say, I have loss of use. And then work your way carefully through that, because if you have to litigate because you feel like you're not receiving enough funds from your insurance or something else happens, you don't want them to come and say, well, you said that you weren't going to rebuild, so we priced you a non-rebuild, or you said you didn't have anything in the house. Don't give them more information than you need to give them in order to get your assistance, your initial assistance from your insurance. However, most of the insurance companies have been really helpful to people so far. and are helping them build inventories of the things that they've lost, helping them gather photos and evidence of what's been lost, and helping them file their claims. So it's very rare that you have to fight with your insurance beyond just keeping an open dialogue and communication with them back and forth, and not telling them things that they don't ask for directly. There's a lot of information that I was able to glean from attorneys that I've been meeting with over the last 2 weeks who specialize in insurance and disaster claims. And we are going to post some of that information on our website that we got from those attorneys. A few attorneys actually holding free workshops for dealing with insurance claims here on island. I know that Foster Law, which helped litigate a lot of the lava flow victims' claims with Lloyd's of London, they're actually doing a free information session on Wednesday and Thursday night. So we'll post that as well. So you hopefully will not need to speak with an attorney if you just have a regular insurance claim. Some people like to have an attorney to help them, but with a regular insurance claim, it may not be worth it financially. So that's something that you can talk to friends, talk to people who've been through this before, and they'll kind of walk you through that. If you are filing an insurance claim, and even if you aren't, if you didn't have insurance, it's good to get an inventory of the things that were lost. And for me, this was the hardest part after our fire, but also the most therapeutic. I spent about 2 weeks, almost 4 hours a day, going through old pictures, pictures that families and family and friends had. This was kind of a little bit prior to digitizing everything, so we lost a lot of photos in the fire, but I also had to find photos because we didn't have one single area where, you know, one single hard drive where all the photos were. But finding those and putting a really, really detailed inventory list together is imperative if you have a high personal property limit. So on your insurance claim, it'll say personal property or contents, and my house in Makawa is only $25,000. The house that we lost before, we happened to have a really high personal property limit, and it was $80,000. And so it was important for me to get really, really detailed on our inventory list. So I put things like Pepto-Bismol, six pencils, a stapler, 4 cans of tomatoes, you know, super detailed hairbrushes, toothbrushes, razors. And I actually walked through other people's homes to look and see what was in a home, because I was just so distraught by this loss that I had a hard time just even getting my mind straight. But it helped me to walk around someone else's home and say, oh yes, we had towels, and then writing the towels down, and I could remember what they were and what sizes they were. But it took me walking around and looking at what other people have: waste baskets, laundry baskets, all those things. And it kind of depends on your personal property limit. You want to go about 25% over what that limit is, because there's some depreciation that happens on those inventory items. And you need to put on there a really detailed description of what it is. So sofa, and then you put American leather hide-a-bed sofa purchased in 2010 from this place. It was orange and green, and you know, it was 11 years old, and the original purchase price was $1,800. So you're going to put all of those things on this inventory list. There's a lot of templates. Again, some of the information that we post will have that, so you can look that up on our website. And you can look at some inventory examples. You might want to just start a Google Drive document and start doing that inventory if you don't have access to a computer, which I know a lot of you don't. This is something you can start on paper when you're ready. Another thing that is important to do, and I know a lot of people have started on this, is just regathering important documents. So from your insurance company, you need to get a certified copy of the policy that you had if you had insurance. If you didn't, you need to get a copy of the lease or the mortgage. Well, you should do this anyway, but you need to get a copy of that. And that's available on like the Maui property search. But if you're a renter, you need to get a copy of your lease as well. You need to get birth certificates and social security cards and all those things. But those aren't as important right away. For me, I spent about 6 months doing that, just kind of on an as needed. I was just telling a couple friends yesterday that I still have not got one of my kids' social security cards. And you would think that would be a problem, but it hasn't, because she hasn't needed to work. But then it has been a problem as she's needed to get her driver's license and things. And so it's helpful to just get a list of things that you need and then just start crossing them off as you get them. Titles to your car. There's a lot of paper documents that we still use as a society to prove ownership and to prove things like where people were born and that they're, you know, naturalized citizens, or if you're a legal alien, then you might need to get your immigration documents. So it's good to do those. I'm working with a group, we call ourselves the Paperwork Warriors, and we're working to get important document holders that are water and fireproof, that are easy to carry, because I know a lot of you are going to be displaced for a while and moving between temporary housing. Hopefully not too much, but it does happen. And so it's good to have just one place where you keep the documents as you gather them. And hopefully you have something that has information in it, like you've left with a phone or hopefully a wallet or something. But if you haven't, just when you call places, call the credit card company and let them know what has happened. And they're more often than not really, really helpful and really eager to get you the things that you need. And then finally, something that's important to do over the next couple months is to just document everything. What are you spending to survive right now? What do you need? Like, it's a good, even if it's something you don't need right now, but if you're like, in 4 months, I'm going to need larger clothes for my kids, or I'm going to need a job, or I'm going to need, you know, it's good to write those things down. Keep a list. Like, what do you see yourself needing? There's lots of people that want to help. And I know how hard it is to accept help. At the beginning, you need help so badly you can't do anything. But then you want to just stand on your own 2 feet and not have that help and feel strong. But let the community help you. Let them come to your aid. Let them know what you need. They're more than willing. I'm speaking as a member of the community who was not affected in this disaster. Let us know what you need and let us be there for you. It might be things like babysitting. It might need things like you need your car cleaned. And if you've been displaced before, you know that your car gets really dirty and it's hard to clean your own car. If you need your car clean, let people know. Do you need fresh fruits and vegetables? You know, my husband and I kind of tag teamed at shelters for about a week. People just wanted some fresh fruits and vegetables and it came, but you know, that's something, it's good to take inventory of your own needs and to let people know. And for those out there who are not afflicted directly by the disasters, think outside the box a little bit. You know, not everybody needs like 10 outfits. And especially when you're displaced, it's really hard to pack up your clothes and move them. And if you've lost everything, if you're in the situation and you've lost everything, maybe you feel like I did, where I didn't want to own anything. I wanted my things back so badly that when people tried to give even like photos, like they tried to give us, you know, copies of photos that were lost, I didn't want them. Like, it was just really a struggle. And you may be feeling all sorts of different emotions. But for those of you who are out there trying to help, keep that in mind. Like, we don't want to burden survivors and the afflicted with things that they don't need quite yet. Let them tell you what they need, but also look for ways to do service that is not tangible. So things that you can do to just lift their burdens. Maui Pono Network is always out there trying to just keep people involved in governance, help keep the government honest, open, and make sure that things are fair and equitable, and that we have a greater level of democracy in Maui County. We're still there. We're still here. We would like to provide you with as much information. So if there's questions that you have that you'd like us to use our network to get answers to, let us know. And that's how Maui Pono Network as a group would love to help the community. Aloha. Hope you're safe and well. And we're all thinking of you.